looking back. Looking forward. Looking down. Looking up. Looking around. Come, join a journey of exploration to the distant past, to the frontiers of tomorrow, from the infinitely small to the infinitely large. The mysterious, the mundane. Come, let us travel to the horizons of knowledge. This program has been made possible thanks to a generous grant from the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, the Vodafone Egypt Foundation, the OPEC Fund for International Development, and the Carnegie Corporation of New York. Today, I want to discuss one of the most powerful ideas that science has brought into the world, Darwin's theory of evolution. It is the overarching theory of biology. Without it, we cannot explain how we breed animals and plants, how pests acquire resistance to pesticides. Ever since it was formally articulated, it has brought organization to the enormous diversity of life. And the diversity of life is truly enormous. Thanks to Darwin, this enormous variety has been explained, and not only why it exists, but even that it is traceable to a common ancestor. Darwin managed to put all the order of that and to assemble all the species of the world into his masterwork. Ever since the publication of The Origin of Species about 150 years ago, every discovery has supported the grand lines of the theory of evolution. This is a magnificent story of a great scientific edifice, a great revolution launched by a very modest and self-effacing man, Charles Darwin. Let us learn a bit more about Darwin and evolution. We all think about evolution. Aristotle reflected on evolution. So did the great scientists of the ancient Library of Alexandria. And so did the great Muslim scientists of the Middle Ages. Western sources usually do not give enough support to the enormous contributions of the Arabs and Muslims. But here, they're powerful, unfettered voices as they lay down the foundations of the modern scientific method, as they encourage people to listen to the contrarian view and accept it, no matter how offensive, if it is supported by evidence and argument.
Centuries before Bacon, Descartes, and Galileo, Ibn al-Haytham,
in the 10th century laid down the rules of the empirical approach, describing how scientific methods should operate through observation, measurement, experiment, and conclusion. We start by observing reality. We then proceed by increasing our research and measurement, subjecting premises to criticism, and being cautious in drawing conclusions. In all we do, our purpose should be the search for truth, not supportive opinions. From Kitab al-Manadir, Ibn al-Haytham. Likewise, listen to the voice of Ibn al-Nafis from the 13th century on accepting the contrarian view, subject to the test of evidence and rational analysis. When hearing something unusual, do not preemptively reject it, for that would be folly. Indeed, horrible things may be true, and familiar and praised things may prove to be lies. So spoke Ibn al-Nafis in Sharh Ma'an al-Qanun.
Now, an interesting thing for Egyptians is that there was an Islamic scientist named Al-Jahiz who lived 1,000 years before Darwin and wrote a book called The Book on Animals. And in that book, he actually observes that animals are in a struggle for existence and that the animals that succeed best are those that create traits that are valuable and they pass them on to their offspring. This means that Al-Jahiz understood a key element of evolution 1,000 years before the famous Charles Darwin.
Listen to the insightful description of Ibn Khaldun on the organization of species. One should then take a look at the world of creation. It started out from the minerals and progressed in an ingenious, gradual manner to plants and animals. The last stage of the minerals is connected with the first stage of plants, such as herbs and seedless plants. The last stage of plants, such as palms and vines, is connected with the first stage of animals, such as snails and shellfish, which have only the power of touch. The word connection with regard to these created things mean that the last stage of each group is fully prepared to become the first stage of the newest group. The animal world then widens. Its species become numerous, and in a gradual process of creation, it finally leads to man, who is able to think and reflect. This is as far as our physical observation extends. Ibn Khaldun. Ah, but the great tradition of the East was to find its modern echoes in the West, not in our countries. As the scientific revolution followed the European Renaissance and the new scientific outlook began to take hold. Copernicus knocked out the centrality of the Earth in our view of the universe. And Darwin knocked out the special status of humans as a species in the diversity of life on this planet. Both were vilified and attacked by bigots. Both played a central role in allowing us to understand the reality of where we live and who we are.
Darwin challenged us to rethink the questions, who am I, where do I come from, and how do I fit into the world?
Indeed, in the grand scheme of things, Darwin has given us the remarkable means to redefine the role of humans. We are the only species capable of appreciating the diversity of life and the fragility of our ecosystem. and to recognize our responsibility to change our behavior in order to safeguard life and the world we live in. The story of Darwin, his quest for knowledge, and his epochal discovery, the roles of Wallace, Huxley, and others in their unquenchable search for understanding and their unwavering defense of truth as they found it, is a marvelous introduction to the exciting journey of discovery that is science. It is an invitation to promote rationality, to adopt evidence-based approaches, and to arbitrate disputes by a coherent set of rational rules as to falsifiability and refutation. What a marvelous antidote to the blinders of obscurantism, fanaticism, and xenophobia. Let us start with Darwin. Here, I am standing in a special hall in the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. There is a special statue of Charles Darwin, copied from the original in New York. Darwin, the father of evolution as we know it. He was not the first person to talk of evolution, but he was the one who provided a comprehensive framework supported by evidence on evolution and the origin of species and the diversity we see. Many spoke of evolution before Darwin, so why is he so famous? Because he explained how evolution works through natural selection. And famous he is. Here are these great testimonials from great scientists.
Well, Charles Darwin was a 19th century English gentleman who observed what many others had seen, but thought about it in a different way and began to ask, why do certain species occur in certain places? Why are many species related to each other in interesting ways? And he began to understand something that no one had understood before, that we are all linked by an evolutionary chain.
Darwin was an extraordinary man who had the insight that all organisms on Earth are related to each other.
Charles Darwin had a profound impact in the way that we think about biological diversity in the world nowadays, because he pulled together the theory of evolution through natural selection. And it really allows us to understand why there is such a diversity in this life of all these life forms, and very importantly, how this happens, how we look at changes that happen in populations and how these lead over time to multiple species.
Darwin would provide the pivotal idea that links all creatures, big and small, living and extinct, namely evolution through natural selection. Others, including his own grandfather, Erasmus Darwin, had proposed theories of evolution before, but no one had proposed the mechanism that makes it work. That would be Darwin's seminal contribution.
Charles Darwin was the first person to put the notion of evolution on a firm scientific basis. He convinced the world, basically the thinking world, that evolution has occurred.
A small, modest man, initially training for the church, Darwin became a botanist and joined the Royal Expedition on the Beagle, a ship that would travel around the world. He made many stops before returning to England. But one of the most famous stops was the Galapagos Islands in the Pacific off the coast of Ecuador. Here, undisturbed nature allowed Darwin to study the variation between birds and especially the beaks of finches. Darwin collected specimens, observed nature, drew sketches, and his notes would be the basis for a long reflection that finally led him to his conclusions. And one day, a correspondent of his, Alfred Wallace, sent him a manuscript. It was the same ideas that Darwin had been working on all these years.
في راجل اسمه ألفرد والاس كان في الملاي وداروين بيشتري منه عينات، بعت له رسالة طبعا راح من مركب إن يعني أنا بتهيألي إن الموضوع ده هو ماشي سلسلة، وإن يعني نفس النظرية أساس بتاعت النظرية بتاعت التطور، وأرجوك تبعت الرسالة دي للجمعية اللي هي سميها اللينائية لنشرها. يعني طبعا كان في إيده إن هو يرمي الرسالة دي أو يقول أنا ما وصلتنيش، خد الرسالة اللي بتحرق البحث بتاعه ووداها له، وأنا فضله الراجل ده بعت لي الرسالة دي وأتأمن عليه. تانيين كانوا برضو أمناء قالوا له أنت بقالك سنين بتكلمنا على هذا الكلام، صحيح أنت ما نشرتهاش، فاسمح لنا أن احنا هننشر هذه النظرية تحت اسمكم انتوا الاثنين. فده سلوك أخلاقي نادر.
Finally, Darwin published a paper at the same time as Wallace in 1858. And the next year, Darwin released his bombshell, The Origin of Species, in 1859. It reflected the enormous work of Darwin over more than 20 years.
The Origin of Species was Darwin's most famous book, and he published that in 1859. But he started thinking about evolution back at least as far as 1832.
With its meticulous documentation and systematic marshalling of evidence, the book became an instant bestseller and has never been out of print since. It also established Darwin as one of the most preeminent scientific thinkers of all time. What Darwin did was to explain how all the species we observed were related, and how they were all descendants of the same ancestors. Descent with modification, gradually, over very, very long periods, leading to different species, some becoming extinct, while others thrived. The mechanism was natural selection, survival of the fittest to the environment.
Selection is an idea. It says basically, as Darwin himself wrote in his notebooks, three principles will account for all. Grandchildren, like grandfathers, he said, should have said grandparents. That means there's some principle of heredity out there. And then he said that there's a tendency for variation. Only those organisms best able to cope with the environment, to get those resources, to resist being eaten by something else and so forth, will be the ones who tend to survive and to reproduce.
These remain the basic tenets of the prevailing view of evolution to this day, even if we've introduced many small variations and additional explanations. And new evidence since the publication of the book has tended to support Darwin's views. Variations are disagreements in detail, not on the overarching premise. A prime case in point would be the view advanced by the late Stephen Jay Gould and Niles Eldredge about punctuated equilibrium.
Punctuated equilibrium is a theory that I developed with Stephen Jay Gould in the 1970s. Darwin left us pretty much with a picture that as you go through time, things will inevitably change. The environment will change and natural selection will make things change slowly and gradually through time. And what we said is that evolution is true, but species tend to remain more stable than Darwin was suggesting is the case. So what we're saying is that species stay stable, and then when evolution happens, it tends to be relatively rapid in splitting events, and then there's more stability. So it goes more like this than it goes like this.
So what was Darwin's view of the relationships between species? Actually, we know. He drew this important little sketch of the tree of life emerging from a common ancestor. It's amazing how the modern view is so similar to Darwin's original sketch.
But what about human beings? Actually, Darwin barely mentions humans in his masterwork, The Origin of Species. He tackled the issue later, 12 years later.
But 12 years after The Origin of Species, he published The Descent of Man, in which he postulated that humans and great apes were descended from a common ancestor, a view that was later to be supported by new fossil discoveries and the mounting evidence of DNA.
The Descent of Man, well, that's another book that he wrote, but he felt all along that if life has evolved, he could not make an exception for human beings.
Indeed, it seems that the great apes branched off on one side, and then from the second branch, the hominids branched off from the chimpanzees some 6 million years ago, and from the hominids evolved the modern hominids and finally ourselves some 200,000 years ago.
There is an incredible wealth of evidence that has been discovered since the time of Darwin. Basically, when Darwin wrote The Origin of Species, there was one fossil skull cap of a Neanderthal, most similar to this one from Belgium, that had been discovered. And since then, there have been about 6,000 fossil individuals of early humans and modern humans discovered.
There's no doubt that apes and humans share a common ancestor.
All of the evidence that we have from the fossil record and from the genetic record really match up. The evidence that modern humans, our species, Homo sapiens, evolved in Eastern Africa about 200,000 years ago. Evidence from modern human genetic diversity and the fossil evidence both point to that date. The evidence from genetics of modern humans and chimpanzees also point to that splitting off date from a common ancestor of about 6 million years ago.
So he never said that humans are descended from apes. He said that both had a common ancestor, but that was the attack used by his enemies. Darwin's views created a furor in the world. Scientists disagreed. The church was opposed. Debates were launched, some immortalized in these cartoons, including a famous debate between Bishop Wilberforce and scientist Huxley. Now, Darwin himself was a shy and retiring man of feeble health who seldom left his country home and rarely participated in public events. In fact, he lived and studied and wrote in that house for 40 years. He died in 1882 at the age of 73. One of the most honored scientists in the pantheon of great discoverers. He was to remain, to this day, a figure of controversy with the non-scientific public. Among the non-scientific public, there were many who wanted to believe that God literally created the world in 6 days measured as 24-hour days we know, and who wanted to believe with Bishop Usher that the entire history of the world was only a few thousand years old. But the accumulating weight of evidence in favor of the long view and the theory of evolution gradually prevailed. After Darwin, evidence continued to accumulate. Mendel worked out heredity. Others introduced population genetics and how traits spread in a population. Finally, genes sitting on chromosomes within the nucleus of the cell were identified as the agents of intergenerational transfer of traits. The race was on to find the ultimate molecule that encoded for life and passed on traits from generation to generation. Almost 100 years after the publication of The Origin of Species, a few brilliant young people would discover the structure of DNA, the famous double helix, and explain how the building blocks of life actually worked. The great discoveries in the second half of the 20th century and the first decade of this century have opened unbelievable vistas of a sub-microscopic world of enormous complexity, beauty, and order. It is an exciting story
of cooperation and competition, of insight and dogged work, of genius and discovery that led to our ability to manipulate the very building blocks of life itself. How we came this far in so short a time is an exciting story full of interesting characters. But that is a story for another day. I am Ismail Serageldin, and I thank you for having joined me in this episode of Horizons.